First of all, a quick run through how does the online media world work. Online, you have different providers of content. You've got editorial websites, staffed by journalists writing articles just like they would do for a newspaper. Slight difference is they haven't got deadlines in the same way because, of course, they can post something at any time. They haven't got column inches to worry about because pretty much they can put up as many pages as they like. So that does make for a different sort of editorial site to, say, a newspaper. And they can be mainstream, like The Telegraph and FT.com, covering all sorts of things. Or they can be niche, like someone like The Register, which is all about the IT industry, if people are in the IT industry. But they have similar elements to just dealing with any other sort of almost traditional type of publication. And they aren't necessarily sat there waiting for your story to arrive, your press release, etc., because they need to write stories no matter what happens. So getting coverage on those can be difficult, but if it's a very niche editorial site, potentially you could get them to talk about you if you're relevant. Next up, are there publishers? Clearly in the offline world, it's very expensive to set up a newspaper or a magazine. You've got to have printing presses, you've got to produce things, you've got to have distribution networks. It costs a lot to distribute a publication to the world. Online, it costs next to nothing. So you get different types of publishers. You get what I would call a selective publisher, something like Earth Times. This is one that is selectively choosing to publish things that it gets from other people, so for instance, maybe your press release, because it's relevant to its audience. So if you had a site that was all about telecommunications, but it's trying to work on a relatively small budget, it's trying to build an audience and sell that audience from an advertising point of view, it needs content. So if your press release was related to telecoms and it was of sufficient quality and relevance, then they just might publish it in its entirety. Now, some people with a PR bent would say, that's not PR, Adam, because that's not real PR, that's not an editorial piece. Well, I would argue it's your story in your words. So surely, who can tell your story better than you? And that's effectively what they'd be publishing. There's a lot of editorial sites that also allow you to comment. Slight difference, though, I would say, between an editorial site that allows you to comment and a blog is there has to be a two-way dialogue. In other words, whoever wrote the blog post, the blogger, needs to respond. Otherwise, really, it's just an opinion piece that people are commenting on. So some so-called blogs, I'm not sure, are always blogs. Some so-called editorial aren't necessarily always editorial. To me, the key definition of a blog is it's got to have somebody talking in a two-way with their community. That makes it very powerful and equally, sometimes, quite dangerous. Finally, you've got user-generated content, and by that I mean YouTube. I also mean things like Wikipedia. Slight risks of, you know, every child using it to produce their homework, but it is user-generated content and it is very powerful, as it gets about 700 million visitors a year. So, well, what's that to do with PR, Adam? Well, if I go to research your company and I find a record of it and I find stories being told about you, that's user-generated content talking to you. Equally, that's two-way. In a sense, Wikipedia, because it can be updated, is two-way, but also you can comment on a YouTube video. It's not just YouTube these days. There's umpteen video sharing sites and other user-generated content platforms. When people in a PR context start talking about Facebook and Delicious and social bookmarking, social networking, or microblogging, it's just people talking about things. This is not coverage, as you would think of it in a PR context. It's not providing content. It's talking about it, just like we do in the real world. The only difference is, instead of being down the pub or around the water cooler, I'm bookmarking something because I was interested in it. But in a social bookmarking context, if anyone knows how it works, effectively, every single other person who has an account with, say, Delicious, can see that I did. You can see that I did, for instance, as in if you're interested, you can go to Delicious/Parker/Adam and see what I've been bookmarking the last few days. You could, though, also go in and do a search for your company. You could also go in and do a search for certain tags, and you see what articles people thought were interesting about that topic. It's virtual word of mouth. In a social networking context, I'm not talking about silly widgets on Facebook pages. I'm talking about somebody sharing something with their friends, saying, hey, this is interesting. Have a look at this. In a microblogging context, I'm talking about doing at so-and-so, which is what you do on Twitter. You at a person, as in their name, and say, I saw this. You might be interested. Link to it. That's word of mouth. Word of mouth is what public relations is all about, because public relations is all about people saying things about you, not you saying things to them. The internet is far more conversational in nature. If you read a newspaper, you can't think, oh, I'm interested in that, let's go and have a look at it. You can't, but on the internet, you can. Okay, you can press the red button, but it's not quite the same thing on the television either, is it? So you can find things on the internet. Of course, they have to be there to be found in the first place. And the last things are, it's on a platform that is this internet. It's not just about the media, and the internet is accessible 24/7. These are all things everyone knows, but that makes it incredibly powerful. From any device, from your mobile phone these days, it's global. Imagine what it would cost to set up a worldwide telecommunications magazine and distribute it. It costs next to nothing to set up a worldwide telecoms publishing website. It's measurable in a way that you just can't do offline. You can't see that 200 people have bookmarked a particular article in Delicious Eye, that 200 people around the country have decided they want to talk about this particular topic very easily without doing an awful lot of market research. But online, you can see it, and you can see it for nothing. And finally, it's durable. It lasts. This works both ways, of course. Something that's really good that people are saying about you will be there possibly forever. Equally, something that's not so good about you will also potentially be there forever. And one does have to wonder about our children growing up, putting their entire lives on the internet, and what will that mean for the current generation? We might find out in the future. So there's a whole debate around that, but it is still therefore very powerful if you get people saying good things about you. This is a world that gives you opportunities to tell your stories that just don't exist in the real world, and to track those stories and to understand those stories. And it's got significant, relevant communities and audiences that would be interested, potentially, if you just go out and look for them. And it has the potential to mean that other people will say great things about you, which is what good PR is, and that they could even do it through Google, because effectively, Google is your reputation management tool.